Hello, everybody. Oliver G here from the Earful Tower podcast. This is a show about Paris, and it is brought to you by Patreon supporters all around the world. Thank you to all you members. Patreon.com/the Earful Tower. Speaking of Paris, you ever thought this is a bit of an impossible city? Well, you might just have something in common with Simon Kuper, a British man turned Parisian who is today's podcast guest. He's written a new book, Impossible City, Paris in the 21st Century. And I welcome him now in the studio to talk about life over 25 years in the City of Light, how it's changed, and what's in store, not just for the Olympics, but the future. Here comes Simon Kuper on the Earful Tower. Simon Kuper, welcome to the studio.
Thank you.
How are you doing?
I am between London and Paris a lot these days, and so I'm always slightly confused which city I'm in.
Uh-huh. Do you need a clue?
Give me a clue.
You cycled here and it felt dangerous, or could that be both?
It could be both, but yes, it was Paris. It felt particularly dangerous because my brake was not working properly, so I am very happy to be here.
We could start with cycling, actually, because that's a really that's a big part of Paris right now. You talk about it in your book, your new book, which we're going to be talking about, Impossible City, sitting in front of me right now. How much has the city changed with cycles, with bicycles?
It has been quite a massive change. I read the other day there's 50% more bikes than cars in Paris now. Number of cars has gone hugely down. And 5 years ago, when there was that endless transport strike, you'll remember, I bought a bike for 200 euros. And since then, I've been going around on a bike and seeing, especially during the pandemic, the number of bike paths has hugely increased.
Yeah.
You know, this was a city where in the 90s, bikes did not exist at all, which is weird because Paris is quite small.
Yeah.
It's mostly flat, perfect for cycling, and they didn't do it.
Yeah.
In fact, Parisians cycled until about the 50s and then came the car and it all ended. So it's a much better city now. I feel much healthier going around on a bike. And it just makes sense because Paris is such a dense city. It's the densest city in Europe. It's denser than New York City, denser than New Delhi even. And there's just not space for all the cars that we're trying to cram into it. And bikes makes more sense for this place.
I've got a big issue with parked cars. I feel like it's the ugliest part of Paris, the parked cars on either sides of the street. And I have a dream of what this city will look like when they're all gone. Maybe that will be tied to bikes taking over. Do you think that's something I can count on happening?
Well, it's already happening. I mean, there's far fewer parked cars than, say, 5 or 10 years ago. We don't notice it because it happens gradually. In summer, so quite soon after we're talking, the restaurant terraces will be allowed. Every restaurant and cafe can grab the parking space in front of it without asking permission. You can just do it and turn that parking space into a terrace.
Yep.
You can put your tables out there, and that's what they'll be doing from April through October. And so cars are already being pushed back, but you're right. I mean, cities are made for people, not for cars. And given how much a flat costs in Paris, it's amazing that we let a lot of people just put a car outside for free.
Mm.
Often the car has more space than a person in Paris, mm-hmm. because, you know, a lot of people have like 10 square meters if they're in a family home.
Mm, true. And in fact, I want to talk about apartments because you've got one of the more incredible apartment stories that I've heard. But first, I want to rewind a little bit. You moved here 2001, right?
2002, I'd say. I bought in 2001.
Yeah. Okay, right. So 2002, you got here, and part of your job as a journalist, as a writer, is observing, seeing what's happening. Do you feel that you see Paris through different eyes of someone who's, you know, just living? You know what I mean? Like, you're sort of thinking about it. You're writing about it. Do you think that changes the way you perceive the city?
I always look at things with a bit of distance. I think, you know, partly because I was raised living in foreign countries. I grew up mostly in Holland. Also because my father's an anthropologist, which is kind of the study of culture. So you're always looking at places and thinking, huh, why do they do it this way? Yeah. What does the handshake mean in France? What does the double kiss when you meet? What is that indicating? What are the rules of politeness? I'm always trying to figure those things out. And so the book is a kind of anthropological study, if you want, but written in, I hope, very simple journalistic language about how Parisians live and how they think. So yeah, I always view the city with sort of through spectacles with a little distance.
Mm, you talk about it actually towards the end of the book about being, there's something about being an outsider. You're kind of comfortable with being a stranger, being an outsider in different countries. Partly probably because you've grown up in all these different places. What is it though about Paris that made you, like, that hooked you and made you want to stay?
The food, I think.
The food, yeah. You're mentioning that an awful lot. The lunches. But surely there's more, there's good lunches around the world. What is it because you could have gone anywhere.
Not as good as in Paris. I mean, Paris, for a start, you just end up every bit of food you eat, you just feel good. I remember in London 25 years ago, I'd buy bread, long life bread in plastic from supermarkets. Mm. And at lunch at the Financial Times, I'd go out to this cafe called Harper's, but it was known as Toilet Harper's because it was in converted public toilets. So that was the kind of level of gourmetness that we were experiencing in London in those days. And then you come here and you go outside at lunchtime and there's 10 restaurants within a couple of minutes walk. And they all have a set menu, which, very affordable. The most affordable good food, good meal in the world, I would say, is a lunch in Paris. Mm. That's really seductive. That really does matter. I'm not just being flippant like saying I stayed here because of the food. It's partly that. And it's also, I wanted to live in the center of a great city with just so many different kinds of people around you and so many wonderful things you can go and see, from movies to soccer matches to museums. All these people coming through all the time. And I could never have afforded that in New York or London. Mm. And in Paris, because things were so cheap at the start of the century, I was able, as a journalist, I wanted to write and live in the center of a great city. And here I was able to do that.
Mm. Can we talk? There'll be a lot of people listening to us who have no intention of living here, but who have intentions of visiting. There's two things you brought up that I want to sort of clarify for people. If you're talking to a tourist in America right now and they're thinking, I'm never going to cycle in Paris, dangerous. Quick comment on that.
I mean, it is dangerous and you have to get used to the rules or the fact that there are no rules and expect that everybody is going to go through red. But there's very, very few traffic deaths here. Some months in the city of Paris inside the Ring Road, there are zero traffic deaths. And it's probably because everyone's going very slowly because there's no space to go fast. I mean, they would love to be going, belting along at 60 miles an hour, but they can't. Yeah. So everyone's going slowly and the cars are small and Paris is actually going to push out SUVs, which I think is a good thing. Right. So you don't get these kind of massive tanks that you get on American roads.
Sure.
The other thing is my sister, who's an epidemiologist, says that for a man my age in their 50s, the cardiac benefits of cycling outweigh the risk of being hit. Mm. So that's what I'm betting on.
There you go. What about a good street to cycle down? You got a favorite?
Well, the Rue de Rivoli is the one sort of main east-west cycle street. Goes all the way through the center of Paris. Yeah. Private cars are banned. Big bike lanes. But I think the best cycle route in Paris, everyone would agree, is now you cycle along the riverbanks, the banks of the Seine. Yep. And you can go most of the way across the city. There's just pedestrians, no cars.
We're talking on the south side of the river, right?
Either side. You can do it on the right bank or the left bank. And you're cycling through probably the most beautiful urban landscape in the world.
What do you think? Because when you mentioned that, I thought south side because of, down near the Eiffel Tower, where they got that really big space for cycling. A lot of people are training, boxing, everything down there.
Right.
But now on the right bank, there's that big tunnel that the cyclists go through.
So there's a beautiful stretch along the river until about shortly before you get to Concorde, if you're heading west, and then you go through a tunnel that takes on a bike about 3 minutes, and then you come up at the Tuileries Gardens, and then you go down again through Concorde Tunnel, and then you cycle along the Champs-Élysées. So I would say that the stretch from Concorde to Bastille, if you can cycle that with the city around you and above you and the river next to you, that is just bliss.
And to think only a few years ago, that wasn't possible.
It was a motorway. Yeah.
Isn't that crazy?
It's insane, yeah.
Do you think, that tunnel though, I always wonder if they can make anything of that. If there's a way of knocking a part out of it, putting little cafes in there or something. Do you think there's any?
Yeah. I mean, they've got a bit of street art there. I mean, a tunnel is always going to be a bit depressing, dank and ugly. It's well lit. And yeah, you go between these two beautiful urban spaces, but in between you're in a tunnel. Mm-hmm. And that is a shame. I was wondering the other day, actually going through it, does this have to be a tunnel? Maybe it does.
That's what, yeah. I mean, they've tried to neaten it up with some street art and stuff like that, but I think there's potential. That could be the next, it could be the next big thing.
Maybe you buy a coffee there and you go to the bank and you take it out.
Who knows? Okay, and the other thing I wanted to ask for tourists, when you said the menu du jour, the plat du jour, I think it can be tempting for a lot of people to look at a Parisian restaurant menu with 500 different things and choose from them.
Yeah, don't do that. No.
That's what I was going to ask. Walk us through it. You sit down at a cafe. Why go for the plat du jour?
So on weekdays, there's a menu du jour, which is if you want starter, main course, dessert. You can have one out of those three or two out of those three. And that restaurant is saying, this is what we've prepared today. It's fresh food that was delivered by a double park van this morning. It's probably from one of the local markets. This is what is good and fresh today. And it's cheap. So the menu du jour is the cheapest thing on the menu. The other things, that's if you don't want that, well, you know, you can order a steak or a burger or a confit de canard or whatever. But that is going to be kind of reheated from frozen.
Yeah.
And that is not going to be fresh and it's going to be more expensive. So don't do that. Go to a restaurant. If you don't like their menu du jour, then go to another restaurant and get their menu du jour. That's right. The best way to eat in Paris.
Right, right. Good. There you go, everybody. That's the word from the man who's been doing it since 2002.
I've eaten more restaurant lunches here than almost any other Anglophone alive, I would bet. I think so, yeah.
It's funny. When I was reading your book, I feel you and I have had an awful lot in common. I came here as a journalist. I used to eat at my desk, and we had a office that we shared with architects. And these
in Australia, you mean?
No, here in Paris.
Yeah.
And so I just went to the supermarket and got anything. I got those little plastic wrapped sandwiches.
Oh my God, that's terrible.
And I ate at my desk, right? Meanwhile, the architects who shared the office would cook proper hour and a half. They'd be in there. They'd be doing all sorts of fantastic things, drinking wine. And one day, one of them complained about me eating at the desk. They complained to my editor. And he came and said, I got to have a word with you. You can't be doing
I think it's illegal in Paris.
I heard that as well, yeah. It's definitely frowned upon anyway.
Yeah.
But so I got that in common. I also worked when the terror attacks were happening here as a journalist. And then now I started raising my own family here. So reading your book, there was a lot that I could relate
to.
Yeah. And I'm wondering, it seems to me that your life changed dramatically when children not just became involved, but became involved very quickly with twins. Second, it was a kid and there was twins, right?
That's right, yeah.
So like an astronomical change in your lifestyle.
Yeah, we went from a couple without kids to having three kids in 2.5 years. So yeah, we were totally overwhelmed. But France made it work for us because as you'll probably experience yourself, there's crèches which take up a lot of the child rearing for you, which is partly why France has continued to have relatively high birth rate. Having kids anywhere is a struggle, but in France it's more doable than almost anywhere else because the state really helps you.
And how much did it change your life suddenly going to a family of five?
I found it quite hard. I mean, when you have twin boys and you have an older girl who's two at that point, you don't really have any freedom at all. And I found that quite difficult to have gone so quickly from a very free life. Where I didn't even, you know, have to go to an office, to having occasionally you'd get 5 minutes to yourself, and that would be like bliss. Like, oh, I've got 5 whole minutes.
Mm.
Now it's wonderful, and they're teenagers, and life is much easier. My boys have just gone off on a football trip to Bordeaux, so
wow,
I almost can't remember the difficulties of having three children of that age.
Wow, did you you mentioned in the book that suddenly you look in the mirror, you see you've become your grandfather.
Yeah.
How does it feel that that's happened? You also mentioned the book, this kind of, it reminded me of the movie Sliding Doors, you know, this thing where if you had you made another decision, had you stayed in London or anywhere of the other places that you'd lived, does it just boggle your mind to think that you've become a Parisian?
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. I mean, I'd had 5 years of bad school French. I came here speaking very mediocre French. I'd never really... You know, Rick in Casablanca says it's not really my beloved Paris.
Mm.
And that's the way I felt. It was no, you know, I'd seen tourist Paris and all its horrors and rudeness of that time. And I hadn't really got the point of Paris. So I came here just because I was told by a cousin that you could buy an apartment here for what turned out to be £60,000. So in dollars, it was about $100,000 to buy an apartment in the center of town.
You know, 2001-ish, yeah.
2001-ish, beautiful, Haussmannian building. And I thought, obviously, I'm not going to live here. I'm just going to rent it out. And then, you know, my shared apartment in London, the whole sharing fell apart. So I gave it a go here, never went back. And yeah, so now sometimes, like the moments when I'm most integrated with France and Frenchness, like I'm at a dinner with people and we're speaking French for hours, and it feels normal, it feels natural. My French is still deeply imperfect, but it's sort of fluent, but deeply imperfect. Mm. And in those moments, I think, wow, I could never have imagined this. In fact, my kind of training was for German. My degree was history and German. I'd lived in Germany for a year. And after I finished my degree, I thought, you know, I really like Germany and the Germans, but I don't really have any desire to live there. And Germany doesn't really have that kind of beauty of daily life that Paris has in particular, that you're surrounded by beauty, that you're eating beautiful things, that really attracted me here.
I totally get what you're saying. Even the language, I find, like mixes in with what you're talking about as well. I was thinking, I was at a cafe yesterday, and you know, in French, they say, instead of saying take a seat, they say installez-vous, install yourself, which almost makes you feel like they want you to be, you know, become a part of the furniture, become a part of, you know, and stay. And I thought, and, you know, and they often say, qu'est-ce que vous désirez? Like, what do you desire?
What do you desire? Yeah.
Yeah. There's something about that made me realize just yesterday that the language is a part of it too. Like there's something here that I think has caught me in a similar way that it's caught you.
Yeah, I mean, I think all languages can be beautiful, especially when you're coming from them from the outside and you're learning them. So you feel, I'm getting this, I'm mastering this. Mm. And then you see it more clearly than you see your own language. We don't really think about English so much because we were born with it. Mm. And, you know, I felt German was beautiful as well.
Mm. How many other languages do you speak? I know you're in Spain for a while.
We had a year in Spain, and my goal in Spain was to speak Spanish in public, like on a panel or on the radio. And mm-hmm. I achieved that after 9 months. My kids said it was very bad Spanish, but still I think, you know, hey, I did it.
Have you done that in France much?
I've done radio and panels a bit. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And I speak Dutch cause I grew up in Holland going to Dutch school.
Yeah. You ever get confused with all these languages flying around? Do you ever mix them up?
Spanish and French is a risk, because they are so close. So they share 90% of their word roots are the same.
Presumably, you'd think Spanish is easy to learn if you speak French, but I bet it's not.
Yeah, no, it is. It is.
It
it's,
is.
I mean, my kids went from French to speaking, having long conversations with people in Spanish, essentially fluency within a couple of months.
How old were they at the time?
Early teens.
Wow.
No, I mean, I think you've probably spent time there and you'll very quickly figure out a hell of a lot of what's going on. Mm-hmm. So French, Spanish, Italian, it's a gift because there are almost no major languages are so similar.
Mm.
So they're very easy to learn mutually.
Mm. Okay. Well, I'll tag them to the list of things to do. Back to your book. I wonder the risk you usually write, for newspapers. Not the risk, but what's the difference in writing for newspapers to writing for a book that presumably you hope people are going to read in 5 years' time, whereas a newspaper article presumably gets read that day and then disappears?
You hope it doesn't disappear, but it does.
The book or the newspaper?
The newspaper. Right. So a book, I mean, my publisher once said to me, not many books live 7 years, say.
Right.
And so he says, most books don't live as long as a dog or a car.
Yeah.
And so the aim is sort of to achieve that your book lives at least 7 years.
Right.
And so you don't write for the moment. So sometimes I speak to a lot of people who are also writing books and they say, well, I have to, there's this really exciting news event happening and I have to get it into my book.
Mm.
And I think, no, that's not the way you should think at all.
Mm.
You want to be people to be reading your book long after this news event is forgotten in history.
Will they be talking about it in 2031? Maybe not.
Even a year from now, they probably won't.
Yeah.
And the other difficulty is that it's hard to write a sentence, harder to write a paragraph. It's even harder to write a chapter. And the hardest thing is writing a book because you have to create a structure that makes people want to read on and on and on. And the most efficient way is the detective novel, because in a detective novel at the beginning, something happens. Somebody's killed, usually, and the question is either who done it or we know who did it. Are they going to catch that person? Mm. And that question drives you on. So you have to have a question that drives people to turn page after page in the book, and you need compelling characters. Mm. And in Impossible City, I decided I would be the main character because it recounts my 20 years here.
Mm.
You always need to find who are going to be my character or characters. So in some books, I am, some books that I've written, and in other books, there are other people I write about who can take that job.
Mm. You could argue that Paris is also a main character in your book, maybe the main character.
I think you need people. Yeah. Like, there's no movie or novel in history that doesn't have characters. That should be the goal for nonfiction books as well.
Though Paris, as a character, changes a lot in the book.
Yeah.
Something that you've experienced, I've not really experienced at all, that you talk about quite a bit, is the suburbs, the banlieue. I imagine a lot of people listening probably haven't spent much time there at all. Over the 20 years, 25 years that you've been here, you were sort of sucked out into them. And not the, it seems to me the typical people who live in Paris, expats, everybody, everybody ends up, as their family grows, living in the suburbs.
More and more people move out to the banlieue because the city's become unaffordable for families.
Mm, but not you.
No, well, we...
it was football.
Yeah, the reason I began to visit the banlieue was because my kids joined a football club and most of their games were in the suburbs because there's very few sports fields in Paris. There's just no space for sports field in Paris. So every Saturday morning, especially when they were small, and then on Sunday, my daughter, we would drive out to the banlieue, and so you'd find yourself in usually a low middle class or working class suburb at the sports complex, which is artificial fields, people just playing all over the place, accredited coaches, warm changing rooms. So the state spends quite a lot of money in these places. And you'd see people of all colors. And what struck me is it was all pretty harmonious. Mm. And I, you know, I'd walk down the high street before kickoff and I'd get myself a coffee. And you look at the sign saying a new metro is being built here. And so over the probably 10 plus years that I've been doing this, I have kind of become a little bit, I won't exaggerate, but a bit of an anthropologist of bits of life in the Paris suburbs, especially around football clubs.
And you think, I think people visiting Paris, tourists again, do you think that it's going to change over these coming years as this greater Paris, the Grand Paris, is realized? Do you think people are going to start visiting more? Do you think it's still going to be?
I think they will. And I think that the distinction between Paris and the suburbs is going to fade, because right now we know exactly what Paris is. It's this little city that you know from the postcards inside the ring road, the périphérique. Mm. And everything outside the périphérique, the ring road, is suburbs. Mm. But what they're doing now, what the state is doing, they're building 68 new metro stations, mm-hmm. which are going to start. Some have already opened, a lot are opening this summer ahead of the Olympics. And so over the next 7 years. So imagine 68 new subway stations being built in New York or in London. I mean, it's just never going to happen. Mm. This is huge. Mm. And so it's going to be much easier to go back and forth between different parts of what will become one, what is becoming more and more one region. Mm. So instead of saying, I live in Paris or I live in Saint-Saint-Denis, which are really only like a mile apart, you'll say, yeah, I live in Paris. Mm. I live in the Paris region. And bike paths are already sprouting between the suburbs and the city. So it's already becoming much, much easier than it was to go back and forth. And most of the kind of beauty of Paris is inside the city, but not all of it. I was walking around at the Château de Sceaux the other day, wealthy banlieue south of Paris, beautiful park with a chateau. And, it's as splendid as anything inside the city. But, yeah, you have to go outside the ring road to get there.
There are a lot of people. I was talking to a guy I know who grew up in the suburbs of Paris. Now he lives in central Paris. And he said, French guy, he was saying that the suburbs get a really bad rap. People think that they're really rough and dangerous. Yeah. According to him, so he grew up there. His friends all live out there still. He says 10, 20% max could be called rough or unpleasant.
I'd agree with that. I've never felt in any physical danger in the Paris suburbs. And for this book, I looked at the murder rates. So the murder rate in the whole Paris region is 1.2 per 100,000, which is the same as London. It's a quarter of New York, which is famously the safest city in the US. Mm. So the Paris region is four times safer pretty much than New York, your chance of being killed. And yeah, I mean, there's a couple of spots in the banlieue probably which are, you wouldn't want to walk down the street there. Mm. But there are 10 million people who live outside Paris. There's only 2 million who live inside Paris. Mm. And most of those 10 million people are living in comfort. They're working class, low middle class, or they're quite wealthy. There's a lot of suburbs that are quite wealthy as well. And yeah, they only get into the news, the suburbs, when there's riots, which are often then massively exaggerated. Mm. And it completely misrepresents what kinds of places these are.
And that's the only time the journalists are going out there anyway.
Yeah. Otherwise, so if you imagine that Paris didn't exist, then the 10 million people in the Paris suburbs would be the largest city in Europe, the largest metropolitan area in Europe, bigger than London.
Yeah.
And they don't get any coverage except when there's a riot.
Speaking of coverage, the Olympic Games is another big part of the book that we haven't
touched. A lot of it will be in the suburbs, Most of it will be in the suburbs.
Well, first the Olympics, what's your take on it? I think there's a lot of it's divisive. There are a lot of people who are excited. There are a lot of people who are, I'm out of here. There are a lot of shops that want to close, shops that think no one's going to come in, shops that want to double down and get extra staff. What's your take? No one seems sure.
Yeah, I mean, before every Olympics, there's a lot of kind of stress. So I saw that before the London Olympics of 2012 as well. And, you know, is everything going to be ready on time? Is there going to be terrorism and so on? And so these anxieties are completely natural. But I think that what's going to happen is the largest influx of people that Paris has ever experienced. I think they're expecting about 10 million people in a fortnight, which Paris just hardly will be able to handle. A lot of people are making money, as you know, by renting out their apartment for Airbnbs and then getting out of town. It's time of year when Paris is empty anyway, the beginning of August. You know, typically people are on holiday. This is really a city that still stops fully in August. And I mean, there's a lot of mess in the city now because the city's hurrying to get a lot of things done, like subway lines or renovating roads and so on. So the city is a bit of a mess now and people are whining about that, which is completely understandable. But I think that from September, Paris is going to look better and be more functional than it ever has been. All these new metro stations, all these roads will be ready, all these new bike paths will be done. And so we're going to be kind of delivered the brand new city post-Olympics.
Okay, but what about the Olympics themselves? Are you going to hang around?
I mean, I'll be writing some for my newspaper, and I'm just really interested to see. The sport I write most about is football, but I won't be writing much about Olympic sports. In London, I went to the archery, and I thought, what is going on here? I have no idea. And I want to write about how the city responds to this influx and to being the center of the world again. In a way, it's going back to what Paris was 100 years ago, the navel of the world. And for a fortnight, it will again be the navel of the world, the city that everybody is watching, which is a role that Paris had kind of lost over the decades.
And how do you think it's going to come out of it all?
I do worry that something terrible is going to happen. I mean, it's kind of a sitting target. And then I know that crowd security experts, they don't really worry so much about hooliganism in soccer. They worry about crushes. And with 10 million people who don't know the city well, that risk does worry me. So I have some trepidation about the Olympics.
And what about, to finish on a more positive note?
Yes, let's do more positive.
Your wife, Pamela Druckerman, how's she doing? She's been on this show before.
Yeah. She wrote a book that probably sold more than all my books put together called Bringing Up Baby in the US, about raising children in France. And that just reading that book really helped me understand France as well and why we were there and why we decided to raise our children there. She's doing well. She's writing another book. I'm not allowed to talk in public about it, but she is. So you should get her on again.
Well, absolutely. What's it like having two writers in one couple? Do you guys sort of dissect everything?
We do read each other's work. I mean, usually in quite a positive way. I mean, she would give me chapters of Bringing Up Bebe to read. This is 12, 13 years ago.
Yeah.
And I'd read them and I think, yeah, well, this is better than anything I've written. Right. So I'm not sure what I can add here.
Oh, wow. She's a lovely lady. I will absolutely invite her on the show again soon. You're a lovely gentleman. Thank you for being on the Earful Tower. And best of luck with the book, Impossible City. And thanks again for coming in the studio.
Pleasure.
And there you have it. That book, Impossible City, Paris in the 21st Century by Simon Kuper, available in April in the UK, June in the US. You'll be able to track it down wherever you get your books. Thank you to Simon for being on the show, and I certainly will send a message to Pamela. It's been a while since we've chatted to her on the Place des Vosges, I think it was last time. Time to get her in the studio. As for me, a big thank you to all the Patreon members. This show runs due to Patreon members. $10 a month unlocks all the extras, including bonus content, bonus podcast episodes, videos, PDF guides to the city, and a whole lot more. Consider becoming a member today. Linked in the show notes below. That'll do for me. Merci beaucoup, and au revoir.